Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. I want us to spend some time to pray this morning. I want to spend some time to pray. The Lord will strengthen us in the name of Jesus. I want to spend some time to pray in the Spirit and just build up our most holy faith. Amen. Glory to God. See, wherever you are, it's not noisy. Can we just unmute our mics and just begin to pray in the Holy Ghost? It says that praying the Spirit and praying mysteries and edifies itself. Makala
In Jesus' name of prayer, amen. Please, we need to learn to practice continually praying in the Spirit. It is very, very important. It is very, very important. Ensure you engage and practice praying in the Spirit. It's extremely, extremely important. The Lord God help us in Jesus' name. Amen. As we get ready for what the Lord is going to do in our lives in July about increase, and you know, something dropped in my spirit, and it's something dropped in my spirit that I feel like I was reading a scripture yesterday, and I just felt led to speak on it. 1 Kings 17. Let's see from verse 2. 1 Kings 17, verse 2. Then the Lord said to Elijah, go to the east and hide by the Kerit Brook, near where it enters the Jordan River. Drink from the brook and eat what the raven bring to you, what the ravens bring to you, for I have commanded them to bring you food. I've commanded them to bring you food, but my focus is eat what the ravens bring to you. You see, when I don't know, it stood out to me when I was reading it yesterday. And what came to me was eat what the ravens bring to you. And that really speaks to me, it can relate to Philippians chapter 4. I think from verse 11 or 12, where Paul said, I've learned to abound and abase. And I just want to talk about eat what the ravens bring to you. So you find yourself in a season, and that means every season, even though you're in the brook, even if you are in, there's a famine, there's something, there's a provision, there's a way God has wired and created the raven supply. Let me call it the raven supply. The problem is, one, we might not see it. Two, we might despise it. Three, we might continue to downplay that provision in that season. Bear in mind, the entire nation was going through famine. That place was a place, that brook was not just to feed Elijah, but to preserve Elijah, because Jezebel was looking, Ahab was looking for Elijah all through the places, but they couldn't find him. They sent people to look for him, but they couldn't find him. So what am I saying? Is it possible that sometimes we're in seasons where Like, for instance, where we are right now, we're going to pray to God, our Father, Lord, what is your plan? You have a plan, definitely. It says in famine and destruction, we will laugh, definitely. There's a plan that where they say there's a casting down, we will say there's a lifting up, definitely. Lord, how do I navigate this plan? What is the provision? Lord, I want to see it. I don't want to despise it. I don't want to overlook it. And I want to be grateful. Whatever season you are in right now, I don't want to despise it. I don't want to overlook it. I don't want to not see it, because there is, said, it's what the raven brings to you. There is a sense in which we can be in a place and we are looking at what raven or looking at what is being given to our neighbor. We can want something else that is not in that season. All right. And it just stood out to me. I just want to encourage somebody. Wherever you find yourself, there is a programming and provision available to you. There is a programming and provision available to you. I realize that believers that are truly birthed and immersed in the word will go through situations different from people that are not entrenched in the word. It's always different. If you don't really know God for yourself, know him deeply enough through his word, you will navigate seasons and navigate top season, great season, light season. You will navigate it differently from those that truly know the word and are embedded and they know God really well. Drink from the book and eat what the ravens brings to you. This sounds like it came to me as an admonition. Like, in this season, maximize what God has given to you. Maximize the resources made available to you. In this season, maximize it. Maximize what God is going to make available. Maximize the best God is going to give to you. Maximize it. Maximize the relationships. Maximize your time. Eat what the ravens bring for you, who have commanded them to bring you food. Now, if you go to verse 10, verse 8, then the Lord said to Elijah, go and live in the village of Zarephath, near the city of Sidon. No, before we go there, verse 7 says, but after a while, the brook dried up, for there was no rain for anywhere in the land. Listen, the same God that says stay in the brook is the same God that comes in 8 and says, go and live in the village of Zarephath, near the city of Sidon, for I have instructed a widow there to feed you. The same God. So it's not enough that you heard God. You have to be hearing him. I remember how at When Friends Pray, February, as I was coming down the stage, I perceived in my heart it dropped as it wasn't like one of those dramatic nudgings and leadings that I've received. It dropped as an instruction. And I perceived that there was a shift in what God wants to do with When Friends Pray. The same God that helped us to do it every month. We came into a season where it became every quarter. And it became every quarter in Lagos and then any other place. Now, the same God I perceived shifted it that it's not going to be every quarter in Lagos, at least this year. Move the tent. Now, for various reasons. That was what the Lord said, for various reasons. Now, my point is, if I didn't obey and align, I'll be in a position where I'm still trying to make, I'll be probably fighting against the tide. One, two, we'll be trying to do much more than he has empowered us to do. And then what the brook, what the raven brings, that means our resources, I'll be spreading it beyond what God intended it to. Now, a lot of us might be in situations where we are saying, oh God, why is this happening? You need to go and take stock. What has God instructed me, not just then, but now? My time is not enough. My time, what am I not maximizing well now? What has ended? What needs to begin? What do I need to sustain? What do I need to readjust my timing for? So it's not enough to hear God said, oh, start this, do this. You must know what God is saying now. God, things can end. Things do come to an end. And things can last for as long as God wants them to last. Now, what's interesting is the widow, he said, I've instructed the widow. And as I was reading, I wasn't going to go here, but as I was reading that first one, I perceived the Lord said that, so look at, so when he went to Zarephath, as they arrived at the gate of the village, he saw a widow gathering sticks, and he said, he asked her, would you please bring me a little cup, a little water in a cup? And she was going to get it. He called to her, bring me a bite of bread too. And she said, I swear by the Lord your God, I don't have a single piece of bread in the house, and I have only a handful of flour left in the jar and little cooking oil in the bottom of the jug. I was just gathering sticks to cook this last meal, and then my son and I would die. Elijah said to her, don't be afraid. Go ahead and do just what you said, but make a little bread for me first. Then use what is left to make a meal for yourself and your son. For this is what the Lord says. There will be flour. And he just went on to give the prophetic word. And it came to my spirit. Is it possible? Are you the one the Lord has prepared to feed? Are you the answer to, now that for this, Lord, help, Holy Spirit, help me. Are you the one the Lord has prepared to give answer to someone else's prayer, to someone else's request, to someone else's need? Are you the one? Well, you don't see it for so many reasons. Number one, what you have, you think is not enough. It will always be like that. Like, it's funny how even Isaiah 54, that was saying single barren, and I would, your children will blah, blah, blah. He was giving them a promise to expand in a time of difficulty. You will never have a perfect time to expand, to give, to be a blessing, to obey. It will never be a perfect time. It will not be because, oh, wow, now I have all the money. It's interesting that God said, I have commanded the widow, but the widow got there and it didn't look like the widow was commanded. You would have thought that the widow would stand on the road and say, oh, prophet. By the way, as I was reading that scripture, you know, there wasn't a specific widow. They said there was a widow and Elisha was led to that widow. I'm just thinking, I'm not saying this is scripture. If that widow did not yield, is it possible that he will find him, the God will lead him to another widow? Is it possible? What do you think? You can put it in the chat. What do you think? Is it possible that it will be led to someone else? Because God can never be stuck on a person. God is not stranded. God is not stuck. What am I saying? Is it possible that we find ourselves in a place that God is giving opportunities to partner with him, opportunities to put a seed in the ground, opportunity to be a blessing, because he really wants to bless you. And because there's a principle of seed time and harvest will never cease, he really needs to bless you. And he will create opportunities. But the truth of the matter, you must be discerning. If you don't discern, good thing for the woman, she was able to discern that that man was a man of God. Two, she allowed herself to be a vessel to bless. And in blessing, she got blessed. What am I saying? Are you the woman, the widow of the, in Jesus' name, I know you're a widow in Jesus' name, but are you the one the Lord has spoken greatly about, even though you know nothing about it? And heaven is going to bank on your ability to discern. Heaven is going to bank on your ability to discern. Are you in a position where heaven is banking on your ability to discern? Heaven is banking on your ability to discern that which is in front of you is not a setup to kill you, but a setup for a comeback, a setup to be blessed. Exactly. And Elijah, it's very easy to look at the widow and enter pity party and your pastoral heart kicks in. Oh my gosh, she doesn't have enough. How will I ask her? She's just about to die. You must not understand that. Imagine what's in the heart of Elijah. It must be a tough decision. Some of us might be in a place where the Lord is asking us to obey some dangerous instruction and it doesn't look like it because you believe that the widow will be. And that's the thing about how we assume. That's why we have been in a place where we have assumed that we know how God will do it. This is how God will do it. God has given you a word. I will just play it out. And you must have thought that maybe the widow will run out to scream, ah, hello, sir. Hello. You are the one we have been waiting for, but that was not it. And a lot of us, because we're not getting the welcome party, we think because of the instruction God has given to us, we think it's not God.
we're struggling, because we're getting the resistance. Because I from the character of God through scripture, if the woman has said no, how do I know? Jesus said, go into the town, preach the gospel. When you get there, don't carry belts, don't carry anything, almost like this situation. You see, that's the thing about scripture. Use scripture to interpret scripture. Don't carry anything. Don't do anything. When you get there, anywhere they receive you, eat what they give to you. Another scripture. Oh, thank you, Holy Spirit. He said, eat what they give to you. There's something about this scripture about when you're in the season, make do with what God has provided. Why you trust God for expansion? A lot of us are trusting God for expansion, but despising your now. And how you know you're despising your now? You lack contentment. You lack joy. Even if you are trusting God for more, if you're trusting God for more, violates the principle of joy, you are probably in the wrong. There is nothing you have, there's nowhere you want to go to that you are in a place now that we should despise what God is doing in your life now. Then, no matter how I'm trusting God for bigger, I'm going greater. No matter the big vision you have, it must never negate the principle of joy full of glory. It must never negate that principle of staying in the place of joy. I'm expanding. We are increasing. Oh, glory. I go to the north. I expand to the left. I trust God for billions. You cannot trust God for billions and grumble and murmur about the thousands you have right now. There is no amount of great vision you have that you are angry about the fact that, okay, you have a big picture. I'm going to do crusade, right? I'm going to feed 1 million people. But right now, all you can do is feed yourself and yourself. And then you begin to despise. Because as I said in that first chapter, it says, eat what the raven brings to you. Elijah, you are in this brook. If you step out of this brook because of what the raven brings to you is not enough, you will die. Either by the hand of Ahab or by starvation. I know what I've done. And I know the thought I have for you, that thought of good and not of evil. You cannot want expansion or increase more than God wants it for you. So you cannot begin to be disgruntled, angry, bitter towards the very one that has good plans for you. Please, this is a mystery we must master. That yes, whilst we are excited about what is going to come, Jesus said to them, wherever you get to is what they give you eat, is what they have, where they put you. However, if they don't receive you, dust your shoes and they will leave you somewhere else. Meaning that it's not just that particular widow. It could have been any. I say God commanded a widow in Zarephath. Meaning that command is ability to discern. My God, what are the things that God is commanding in this season? That your ability to discern is what will either qualify you or appropriate to you that which has been spoken in this time. So God is speaking about increase. Your ability to discern. Discern the seed to give and to whom to give. Hiya. Do you know it's possible that this woman could have seen a dying neighbor? This woman could see a dying neighbor. This woman could see a dying neighbor and could have given the neighbor out of pity, but the blessing was for her to have fed the prophet. That's another dimension. I've read a book in Bene Gesserit Tibet, where the Lord told a company to stop sowing in a particular place that you are enabling waste. I read it here again. You have to see your seed. You have to guard your seed. You have to guard your seed. You have to guard your seed so well. You have to even watch your obey. So my point this morning is, one, from that scripture, we see where he said that eat what the raven has given to you. Stay in the brook. He remained there until the Lord said, now it has dried up. Move somewhere else. Some of us will still stay in that brook and think that the miracle will be that despite the brook dried up, I'm still being fed. Because we just have a way where we think it's more supernatural if it happens in certain ways. We have a way where our mind is set so that this is the way to look like it's God. So that when you share that testimony, you're like, wow, you mean the brook dried up? And yet, water was still flowing for you. Sometimes God is not in that business of trying to do the dramatic to prove. What he said to him was, move. Sometimes God will not say, remain there, and I will do one creative miracle. Sometimes the miracle is in moving. God will tell you, move from that place to this other place. A lot of us have gotten to a place where the brook dries and we're stuck because all the instruction we knew and we love was the brook. So to go out and look for and go to a widow, go to Zarephath, we don't like that discomfort. And then to a widow, I will show you the unknown. That's it. Stepping into the unknown. Go to Zarephath. I've ordered a widow. No, there was no name. There was no specific address. Just be going. Same thing with Abraham. Take your son to sacrifice to a place I will show you. So you have to follow me on the journey till I show you the place. And when you get there, you realize the widow has to also be discerning, just as you discern the widow. Both people, like both parties, could only access the miracle, one, to be fed, two, for the widow, continuous provision by discernment. It is very important. We must not, thank you, Pastor, we must not miss our Kairos moment. We need to be discerning. A lot of people are, and see, one of the ways you know you're on the right is joy. Guard your joy in this season. Track your joy. Guard your joy. Because it's with joy you draw from the wells of salvation. Joy, the kingdom of God. God told us three categories to discern the kingdom straight up: righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. If you lack these things, if you're struggling with these things, all in the name of I'm expanding, I'm increasing, there's something is wrong. Joy is like your fuel indicator to tell you your fuel is low. Something is wrong. Because joy is connected to your strength. Joy is connected to your faith. It takes faith to be joyful with the raven bringing little bread. And knowing that the raven will come tomorrow, though you are trusting God for an expansion, for to not just to have just enough to eat, but to be a blessing and to have much more. So I want to pray. I want us to pray this morning for discernment, for the grace to be grateful, gratitude. New song, Praise the Lord by what's their name? Let me try and join so I can play this before we go this morning as we praise. Because I heard the Lord say, praise me. Because I was wondering how it will be connected. But I see how it's connected. We're going to spend the next minute to open our mouths wherever we are and praise God. When last did you thank God for the brook? When last did you thank God for the raven? Just enough. That's what you have. That's what it's been. When last did you thank God for the brook? When last did you thank God for the widow? You know, it takes some humility to even embrace being widow. Widow is the one bringing you food. Ha. And I'll tell you practically, I was sharing with them yesterday. And by the way, if you are here, we're having a retreat at Hope Nation. The reason why, you know how all these movies of MCU, all these Marvel movie that they have, what's it called? What's that thing that all the movies, sometimes they merge together. They have this interplay. I forgot if there's a word that we use for it. Where, for instance, Flash is the other guy. But where you have, for instance, there was a time where you see Flash, Arrow, yes, All-Stars, that they all merge. Sometimes is a Flash series, but you see an interplay. You see an overplay with other. So you can see Arrow and Flash movie, or you see like when they were kind of fighting the Infinity Star. Wow, my God. Let me come back. It's okay. My point is, sometimes we have the crossovers. Thank you so much, Onome. Where you have crossovers, it's called crossovers, where the movie Gong Gong is, for instance, Black Panther, right? But then you add different people coming. Or
the movie is Iron Man, but then you see Black Widow, Black, you see all these people, and you have these crossovers. What am I saying? We're having a crossover. Sometimes we see how the opening can interplay something. I refer to the message because it's the same human being, the same me, but different expression, right? We see where when friends is overlapping with IRA and all. So we're having a crossover, and that is we're having a retreat. We're having retreats on the, what's the date now? The 13th of July. It's going to be at Faith Plaza, Bariga. I'm going to drop a link if you want to register to camp. The good thing is, miraculously, there is free feeding for the first 120 people, and it was almost taken yesterday. So if you're interested, you can please come around. It's going to be streamed, so you can also join online. And I brought that up for a reason. I'll share with them how sometimes we're so, yesterday we had a meeting just to help people with registration and all of those things. It's promised to be a great time. By the way, Reverend Tokes is going to be there. Pastor Toju is going to be there. I'm going to be there. Pia is going to be there. The Roberts are going to be there. It's going to be a powerful time of prayer. Last year was amazing. Recalibrate retreat is always amazing. So if you're looking for a retreat, you want to be in a place, please, is a good place to be. Amen. Now, I was saying to them how sometimes we're so consumed. We're in a moment and we don't know how to. The devil steals your moment. It steals your joy. So you're in a season where you have just enough. You now get into the, maybe you now were in a meeting like this and someone is testifying of more than enough. The devil is looking for how to quickly help you think, look at you. Or you're in a season where, because for instance, I was standing for instance at this retreat, there are different categories of rooms. There's a room as low as 500 naira per night. It's a dorm. There's a room as low as 25. There's a room as high as 35,000 naira per night. So you are in this place, a room, some rooms, they don't have AC, but it's fun. And then because of the venue we're using, the light condition is, some rooms have guaranteed 25, they have backup power, 24 hours light. But the good thing about that place is that they are paying, they're on the A-list, so they have light most times. But in case light trips off, oh, this is the condition. Why? So that you have, nobody will say they don't have an opportunity to come. Now, what the devil will do, you come to a place like that. I was giving them an example, talking about this Thanksgiving, and I'm trying to drive home a point. Your devil make you to take your mind off what is major, which is that I need to be at this place at all costs. You will not see that the miracle is, wow, thank you, Jesus, that there can be a room as low as 500. No, the devil make you feel, can you imagine? You are staying at a room at 500. Your mate is staying at Faith or Lodge that is 35,000 naira, or that is 15,000, whatever, 1,000 naira. And then begin to make you feel that God is not good to you. And that is what happens to us all the time. You are in a season where the raven is bringing what you are eating. The devil makes you to see that it is less super spiritual or miraculous. The devil makes you to feel that it is less miraculous. It is less whatever. Right? And make you think that the one that is having what XYZ. Guys, this is one of the secrets. I had to learn it. I had to forcefully find myself in a place where I will always find a reason to thank God. Always. Always. Like, devil, you're not going to take this away from me. And I gave them an example of when I went to, the first time I went to Shiloh. The first time I went to Shiloh, I remember that was in 2012. Somebody blessed me with 5,000 naira. I gave a tithe. I did babysitting. Right, I'd give a tithe of 500, maybe 4-5 at that time. Look at 4-5 was a transfer for me and my sister. It was transfer for me and my sister. It was our Shiloh offering was for meat. You understand Shiloh, they do Shiloh sacrifice. Imagine 4-5. Our feeding was for meat, our transport back, our offering was for meat. 4-5. Now we couldn't even afford, we didn't, number one, know how, if you know how winners is. Hostels are taking like water. We couldn't even get any space. We had to squat to somebody that we met, that met somebody through somebody in a classroom on their mats. We had to sleep in between two mats in a classroom, different people. We had to wake up very early to go and have our bath outside, very early to have our bath, and then quickly rush down to the place,
come back. Hopefully it's open because it has to be locked. I said, at that point, what mattered was I was on that campground receiving what God wants to receive. For some of you, right now, what God is doing is he can feed you and your family. He can feed you and your family. Whilst God will challenge you to expand your thinking and don't limit God to only that he can feed your family. God wants you to think big, see yourself borrowing nations' money. But the problem is there is a disconnect between thinking big and living in joy, despite the fact that your present might not look big. There's that disconnect. And that is one of the things that keeps some people in a place forever. God cannot be mocked. You cannot get anything with murmuring. You cannot get anything out of living a life void of joy, void of the word. You see, it takes joy to make you remain in the word, despite the fact that your presence is not yet matching what you are reading. It takes that faith and is connected. You see, faith, joy, these things, they are all catalysts to something. It takes joy for your eyes to be clean so that you'll be in a place, though you see people having much more, it doesn't enter jealousy, envy, because you have been able to hack that Philippians 4 that talks about contentment. I have learned to abound and abase. This is Paul. This is Paul. This is Paul trying to say, I've seen plenty. I've seen few. Your countenance and disposition must not change despite plenty, few. And this will help you to be able to know what to do per season. Are you in a season where you might have to pick up extra job? Are you in a season where you have to, this is what I've known. I'm thinking maybe on Thursday, I don't know if Tolu will be able to share a testimony. You come from a place, you find yourself in a situation. I'm not talking about overworking, which is Psalms 127, toiling for fear of not having enough. And you lose your rest, you lose your sleep, you lose all of those. No. And I'm not talking about not expecting the miraculous. I'm saying that with joy, you are able to say, Lord, this is the season I find myself. What do I do? How do I adjust in this season? That's what Paul was saying. I've learned to abound and abase. What does that mean? Learn to. I've learned to. It's a skill. It's not a gift. You have to learn to abound and abase. You have to learn to make do with everything the raven is giving to me. Why I trust God to know I can never be stranded. Why I'm excited to see this is just a season. This season will pass. Though the night be weary, joy is coming in the morning. A lot of believers don't know how to do this. We don't have that strength of character to remain. I was talking about the mindset of Joseph. We need to even read the mental capacity. Joseph to remain. How can Joseph be looking at people? They are sad in prison. What should they be doing in prison? How did Joseph, for you to show you that Joseph was not bitter. If he had been bitter, acting only the plan on how to revenge himself and revenge his brothers, how would Joseph be in prison? And you are noticing that people in prison are downcast. Hello? You should be so consumed with yourself, angry at what your family has done. You should be so consumed with how it's not fair. How it's not fair. God has forsaken you. God has, there is no way you can find purpose in a down place if you're not joyful. There is no way you can find a reason to be a blessing and purpose. I'm not talking about accidental purpose once in a while. Continually serving in spite of what you are going through and where you are. It only comes from, number one, you have a good relationship. You have a true relationship with God. You know God for who he is, not just what he can do. Number two, you are a person of the word. Number three, you are full of joy. That is the only way. That is the only way that Joseph can notice that someone is downcast in prison. Of course, they should be downcast in prison. And he can interpret dreams. The reason why his gift did not go to hiding. Some of you, God, your gifts, you have thrown, like, I beg God, it's almost like God is a scam. Please just pack yourself. Let me sort myself out. The reason why he could still work his gifts. You notice that his gifting grew. The Joseph that was talking about dream before he was sold, and the Joseph interpreted to Pharaoh, with two different people. I was asking, what strategic school or business school did Joseph go to? How could he download such smart ideas, strategy from the place of the Holy Ghost? Why? From the place of prayer, he had an interaction with God. He had a personal walk with God. What am I saying? Mr. Otabe, put it this way. Let your problem stretch you. Don't let it cage you. I'm rephrasing that way. Whatever you are going through, let it stretch you. That's part of what Isaiah 54 was saying. Let it stretch you to have faith. Let it stretch you to remain in joy. Don't let it cage you. Don't let it limit your mindset, but don't lose your gratitude. This morning, I want you to thank God. Thanksgiving is a catalyst for more. The brook has dried. God is moving you somewhere else. Okay, Lord, I don't know. And sometimes you will do this Thanksgiving with tears running down your eyes. Sometimes you do this Thanksgiving. Sometimes you find yourself like, ah, God, this is beneath me. But you will thank God regardless. Like, you know what? With God, nothing is beneath me, above me. I will do what needs to be done as led by God, so that I will never be stranded. A lot of times people are stranded because, one, they've lost Thanksgiving. They're not able to learn to abound and abase. They're not able to, okay, God, what do I do in this season? What do I do in this season? That's always my question. Lord, this is what I have in this. How do I? Every time that we've had seasons where there were low times, there were high times, I will sit there, especially with the ministry. God, what do I do? How do I navigate? What do I cut? What do I apply? What do I increase? I'm learning to abound and abate. Because I remember one time where the Lord corrected me, said to me categorically, Imisi, it is an illusion to desire a life without faith. When some of you, I'm sure you say, you can't wait for the time where I can afford everything I want. I can't wait. That's great. Keep desiring it. But the journey will be, you will find yourself in places where, I'm telling you, God's vision will always be bigger than your provision. God, the vision you have, it will always be bigger than the provision you think you have. Why? So that you can always need God. So it's an illusion to expect a life where you will not need God. You will not need God. You will not need to trust. You will not need to have faith. You will not need to trust him for strength. The provision might not even be money. When we talk about provision, it might not be money. It might be strength. It might be the knowledge. It might be your time. It might be something, sir, that you need divine intervention to help you navigate it. So I wanted to open your mouth this morning, wherever you are, and let's thank God. Let's thank God for the raven that is giving you food.
Thank you, Jesus.
Let's thank him for all the details. Thank him for the just enough moments.
Thank you, Jesus.
Can we omit, wherever you are, can you begin to open your mouth and begin to pray this morning? I say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Lord,
thank you, Jesus. Because we know that you're still taking us to a place of more than enough. And if you're in a place of more than enough, begin to thank the Lord. Thank him. Thank him from the depth of your heart. Are you navigating a tough time in your health, in your family? Whatever it is, Lord. Thank you, Lord, I thank you for where we are. I thank you for how far you brought us. I thank you for this position, this moment right here. It might not make sense, but I thank you. I am grateful because I know you are taking us to greater. You are taking us to bigger. You are taking us to better. I thank you. I'm single, but I'm still thanking you. I'm not throwing myself around. I'm not settling down to marry anybody. I thank you that, I have a job, but maybe business have not come. Thank you for making an employer of labor. Thank you because I want to increase, but not where I'm at. Because I'm telling you, that thing you're complaining about was once a miracle for you, was once a testimony. Whatever it is you're complaining about was once a testimony. Was once saying, oh wow, now I have a new job. Oh wow, I have met a car, I have married. Oh wow. Lord, I thank you. Thank you, Lord, for this evening. I thank you, Jesus.
Oh, thank you. We're so grateful, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
So grateful. We're so grateful. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Oh, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Oh, my God, we say thank you. Oh, thank you. Again, my home, please, Lord, Papa. Thank you for many chances.
Thank you for second chances.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you for another opportunity to discover who you are.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Oh, thank you. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for always showing up. Oh,
in Jesus' precious name of prayer, keep thanking God. I want to play a song as we wrap up this morning. I just want you to just thank God. You know, I woke up hearing praise God, but I heard that scripture, but I didn't know how to connect. But thanks be to God for always leading us. Just thank God. Trust me, it's not as bad as you think it is. Just thank God. Don't be stuck. Thank God. Be open with God. Make do of what he's providing right now. Whilst you thank God for the next, whilst you expect the next, what is God doing now? Thank him for it. Navigate it. Build according to pattern. You also discern. Maybe you are the one. Maybe God, a need is coming. Something is coming. But yeah, because you are so consumed with, I want to survive, you are not able to discern that this is a miracle in disguise. Many of us, maybe not pass our miracles. Maybe not pass our miracles. Some of you, I keep saying it, there's a word. There's a word. There's a word that is, that sometimes the Lord has placed you in a place just to receive. I love how Reverend Tosh said it over the last week. Something we have, don't let offense take you out of where God has planted you. Thank God. Thank God for your life. Thank God for the lessons you've learned. If you have made mistakes, thank God, because they are lessons. They are part of the scars of your journey. And we give God praise. Hallelujah. Praise be to God. Amen.
Let's come. One, two. I'm sure.
great day, and don't stop thanking God. So the instruction, don't stop thanking God as you go through your day. Be open for what God is bringing to you and trusting that you will discern. And you go be a blessing. Maximize everything He gives to you. I love how somebody explained it. Maximizing it is making the best of it, increasing it, multiplying it, and being thankful. The Lord will bless you all in Jesus' name. Amen.